Hello legends, it's Guan here. Good to see all of you here today. Thanks for tuning in for today's video. Market crash. Possibly the second scariest thing after having to tell your mom about your lousy exam scores. True story. Jokes aside, in this video, I'll be covering the steps you can do as investors to protect and get ready during market crashes, and the methods that we can capitalize to make money during market crash. Alright, let's begin. Market crash phenomena. Let's face it. Market crashes are considered to be a normal phenomenon that every investor needs to consider. According to NASDAQ, the S&P 500 benchmark index has undergone 38 market crashes of at least 10% since the beginning of 1950. This is like a crash or correction on average every 1.87 years. On top of that, the average length of the 38 declines since 1950 is around 188 calendar days. In other words, each decline is about 6 months long. Moving forward, we as investors always need to know that market crashes are a normal phenomena. In fact, it will be more normal than a rabbit winning against a turtle in a race. Jokes aside, market crash is not something funny, and that many investors who didn't have sufficient knowledge or margin called by the banks would for sure get wiped out like a tornado sweeping off everything. But if many investors got wiped out because of market crashes, how come Warren Buffett and Charlie Munger became richer and richer after every crash? Huh, a big mystery indeed. More mysterious than a black hole, I'm sure the late Sir Stephen Hawking will be confused like this baby. Let's find out why in the next segment. Now before we proceed, please give it a like, subscribe, and click the bell for more video every Friday. In return, let me show you this cute cat. Alright, on to the next one. Secrets of Buffett and Munger. The truth is, Warren Buffett and Charlie Munger were already managing the investment portfolio risk from the beginning before they purchased the stocks. Let me illustrate this. They have already identified a few possible business risks that have the probabilities of happening before investing in the businesses. If they think the business risks are small, they will invest. A simpler analogy would be, if you are buying a laptop, you now have two laptops in front of you. Your selection criteria would be A. The laptop is able to work properly for the next 5 years. B. The price of the laptop. And if laptop A turns out to have a higher chance of working properly in the next 5 years, and the price is more or less same as laptop B, then for sure you go for laptop A, wouldn't you? Another concrete example to describe Buffett and Munger's process is that they are always looking for great businesses with a track record of producing free cash flow with stable return on invested capital. Even better if they can find businesses that don't always need to inject extra capital to generate return, just like how they discovered Coca-Cola, a wonderful business that does not require extra capital from their owners. So, do you think they will straight go out and buy the stocks after concluding they are good businesses? Of course not. They'll be waiting for cheap prices first. Cheap is good. And that is exactly why you've seen them buying lots of stocks during the 2008 subprime mortgage crisis. In fact, Berkshire had around $44 billion of cash in 2008. And Berkshire had put more than $20 billion for investments. That's basically more than 50% of the cash it had in the midst of the market crash.
Huh, but what if I don't have a stock watch list already? How can you still make money during a market crash?
Well, some people do short selling. Alright, into the next segment. Short selling? Let's say you really want to maximize this market crash opportunity. You can do short selling. You know, like the GME and AMC stock shorting saga. Okay, jokes aside, short selling is basically like this. You borrow a Pikachu Pokemon card from your friend and that you return to him later. You happily take this Pikachu Pokemon card and sell it at a marketplace for $10. You now have $10 in your pocket, but you need to return this Pokemon card sooner or later. Now, the marketplace says that the market price for Pikachu card is only $5. So you immediately go in and buy the Pikachu card for $5. So now you have the Pikachu card and return it to your friend, while you happily pocket the $5 for free. Literally.
Wow, so easy one ah. Can make money with zero money?
Hold on. That's just a rosy example of how short selling works. What if the marketplace says that the Pikachu card is now worth $20? You need to top up another $10 to buy back the card. You are making a $10 loss right now. What if the Pikachu card is now worth $100 or $1,000? You are basically toasted. Okay, so now we see that short selling is dangerous for your money. Unlimited downside risk and limited upside risk. This is a high-stake poker game. Why play the game when the odds are against you?
Then, is there any other way to make money during a market crash?
Yep, there is. It's called Inverse ETF. into the next segment. Inverse ETF. Let's say the S&P 500 index drops 5% a day. An inverse S&P 500 ETF will increase 5% a day. So for example, if you think that the S&P 500 index will go down and you want to profit from it, you can buy into an inverse S&P 500 ETF. When the S&P 500 index drops by 5%, the inverse S&P 500 ETF will increase by 5%. Therefore, you can then sell the inverse S&P 500 ETF to profit from the 5% difference as a result of your speculation. Here's a big list of inverse ETFs that you can consider. That's not all, there are leveraged inverse ETFs available. Meaning to say, if the inverse S&P 500 ETF is leveraged to 2x, then a 5% increase in the inverse S&P 500 ETF would mean 10% return for you. Essentially, it's hot big. But here comes a bigger question. Why don't Buffett, Munger, Li Lu, and many other big brain investors buy into the inverse ETFs? First point, inverse ETFs have a high expense ratio. For context, the SPDR S&P 500 normal ETF has an expense ratio of 0.09%, whereas the average expense ratio of inverse ETFs is 1.02%. In other words, inverse ETFs are not good for long-term compounding for people like Buffett, Munger, Li Lu, and the rest. This is because we learned that in the long term, stock market is always in an uptrend direction. The longer you hold on to an inverse ETF, the more money you lose. Then you become set for the rest of your life. Second point, from 1950 until now, we only have had around 38 declines. And can you reasonably predict when the crash will come? If you can predict when a crash will come, just buy the lottery, man. 100% win rate and greater reward payout. Don't bother playing complicated stuff like inverse ETF. So now you see, trying to predict if it will rain tomorrow is already difficult, let alone predicting the market valuation. Inverse ETF is really just a waste of time and money for long-term investors.
Okay, I understand now.
Alright, on to the next segment. My final thoughts. Alright, all in all, there's no free lunch in the world. Do the research, put the stocks into a checklist, wait for the right price, and buy them. Let the compounding flow through you. Let me know in the comments if you'd like to do short selling or buy an inverse ETF and why. Thanks for watching, legends. I'll see you in the next one.